uniting communities throughout the sticks. This is Urban Definition with your hosts Sassan, Kareem, and Zayn on CHHA 1610.
So I forgot my headphones today, and I'm already regretting it. Hashtag random thoughts. Today is Wednesday, April 12th, and you're tuned into a new episode of Urban Definition. As per usual, I am joined by my co-host, Mr. Zayn Jinnah.
What's going on?
But not Mr. Sassan Mirzai.
Aw, man.
How's your weekend been? Or your week been?
It's good. Honestly, you know what it is? It's one of those weeks where you know the long weekend's coming up, and everything has the mentality of, I don't really care about anything. I'm just chilling.
It is a condensed week, isn't it?
It is. It's only by one day, but yet the mentality is still that of like, I don't care. I just don't want to do nothing.
Very true. And every week we forget to do this, but Zayn, please tell our audience how they can connect with us, por favor.
Very good point there. You can connect with us by going to urbandefinition.ca, which is our website, and you can click on our Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram accounts and other social media feeds and tabs that are there and interact with us. You know, go on our Facebook, write on our wall, comment on posts. Let us know you're listening and let us know what you think about what we're talking about throughout the night. Also, Twitter. Twitter is a very useful tool as well. We're trying to use that a little bit more. And also, it would be very effective for us to have a little bit more direct communication with you there. So go on those two tabs and talk to us.
Very true. And with that, let's get to our headline news. And we start with, Malala has become an honorary Canadian citizen. Justin Trudeau presented her with a certificate documenting her as an honorary Canadian. Only the sixth person to receive the honor and the youngest ever. He also presented her with a flag from atop the Parliament building in Ottawa. So for those of you who don't know Malala, she is a Pakistani advocate, and she arrived...
Activist.
What did I say?
I'm not really sure.
Activist? What can I say? It's one of those days. Anyway, she arrived at Parliament with Prime Minister Justin Trudeau this morning, ahead of being made an honorary Canadian citizen. The 19-year-old Nobel Peace Prize winner later addressed Parliament, and she said, and this is actually very interesting, she said, speaking to a joint session at Parliament, she said, the man who attacked Parliament Hill called himself a Muslim, but he did not share my faith. He did not share the faith of 1.5 billion Muslims living in peace around the world. The reason the story came up was because in 2014, when Malala first attempted to get to Canada with her father, that was the year that the gentleman, I forget his name right now, attacked the Parliament buildings in Ottawa. Second story going down, gas prices jump across country due to weak loonie and warmer weather. Spring is here, the mercury is rising, and so are gas prices. According to gas price tracking firm Gas Buddy, the average price today for regular unleaded in the country was almost $1.15 per liter. That's up 19% as compared to last year. The pump prices in the Greater Toronto area are approaching $1.22, while places like Montreal, for example, are $1.27. Dan McTeague, who is the senior petroleum analyst with Gas Buddy, said the highest average gas prices in Canada, aside from the far north, are $1.39 in Vancouver, and the lowest prices are in the Prairie provinces at about $1.03. Canada-wide warrant issued for alleged shisha lounge shooter. A Canada-wide warrant has been issued for the arrest of a 20-year-old man accused of killing a teenager last year at a Mississauga shisha lounge. Mohammed Kashir is wanted for first-degree murder of a Toronto boy. Sharmika Farah, 17, was killed on February 7, 2016, after a shooting broke out in the parking lot of Habibi Lounge near Airport Road and Derry Road East. According to police, who reported at the time, the altercation broke out shortly after 1 o'clock in the morning when several men were seen by witnesses fighting in the parking lot. When police arrived, the victim, who was identified as Ms. Farah, was found with a gunshot wound. She was rushed to hospital, but later died. The police say the suspect is dangerous. They are warning people do not approach him and call police immediately. Anyone with information is asked to call the Homicide and Missing Persons Bureau at 905-453-2121, extension 3205, or Crime Stoppers at 1-800-222-8477. Sean Spicer apologizes for "even Hitler didn't use chemical weapons" gaffe. In a comparison with Assad, the president of Syria, Trump's press secretary said Nazi leader who gassed millions of Jews didn't sink to using chemical weapons against his own people. That's right. The White House press secretary, Sean Spicer, expressed contrition on national television Tuesday after he was widely condemned for claiming that Adolf Hitler, who gassed millions of Jews during the Holocaust, did not use chemical weapons. He compared the Nazi leader with Syria's Bashar al-Assad. Spicer told journalists during his regular press briefing at the White House, "We didn't use chemical weapons in World War II. He had someone as despicable as Hitler who didn't even sink to using chemical weapons." Asked to clarify his remarks, he added, and I'm quoting on this, "I think when you come to sarin gas, he was not using the gas on his own people the same way that Assad is doing." A reporter in the room shouted that Jews had been targeted, to which Spicer stumbled on, "Thank you, I appreciate that. That there was not in the, he brought them into the Holocaust centers, I understand that, but I'm saying in the way that Assad used them, where he went into towns, super confusing." Spicer attempted to once again explain himself on CNN last night and issued a formal apology. Either way, I think Spicer's going to be out of the job soon. Charlie Murphy died at 57. Comedian and brother of Eddie Murphy dies after leukemia struggle. Super sad story. Huge fan growing up. US Weekly reported this morning that Charlie Murphy had been undergoing chemotherapy and his family members, including younger brother Eddie, were shocked by his death. They believed that he was on the mend. According to TMZ, the comedian's family would call him frequently to check in with him, to the point where he would joke they were calling him too much. Charlie Murphy recently toured with Cedric the Entertainer, Eddie Griffin, George Lopez, and D.L. Hughley on the comedy Get Down, but his prolific career extended well beyond stand-up. He co-wrote Eddie Murphy's including Norbit and Vampire in Brooklyn. Celebrities immediately took to social media to express their condolences on the comedy's loss. Some of the quotes or tweets that were sent out, for example, Russell Simmons, "Just came out of meditation and learned that one of my friends and biggest comedy idol passed away. Damn, I loved Charlie Murphy." Another big one came from Ice Cube, who said, "Damn, sorry to hear about my friend Charlie Murphy. He took a chance on a young director in the Players Club. Always made me laugh. Rest in peace." For those of you who don't know, this weekend is what is commonly being referred to as playoff weekend. And that is because, for the first time in a long time, both the Toronto Maple Leafs and the Toronto Raptors are going to be in the playoffs. We're going to start with NHL playoffs. Tonight marks the start of the 2017 NFL playoffs, and games will come down to the pipe as fast and furious as the first round begins. Specifically, the puck will drop on five different contests tonight before the first round, and tomorrow will be the remaining teams. I'm not going to go through the lineup the same way I went through March Madness, so I'm going to focus on Toronto. Game 1 will be taking place tomorrow night at 7 p.m. The Toronto Maple Leafs are scheduled to play the Washington Capitals, which is very scary because the Washington Capitals are actually seeded for the first time in a long time to win the entire Stanley Cup. So if we can beat them, it's going to be a huge accomplishment.
Wow.
Yeah, it's intense. It's insane. Next, it's back here. I've got so many papers today, it's incredible.
You have a lot of notes there, man.
I do have a lot of notes, don't I? Now to basketball.
All right.
The 2017 NBA playoffs are almost here, and we have a good idea as to who's going to be making what and who's going to be playing who. The exact schedule isn't released yet, since the teams haven't been completely determined, and we also don't know how long each series will last, but we do know some of the dates. So with that being said, the Toronto Raptors are scheduled to play the Milwaukee Bucks.
Mm-hmm.
This season, Toronto's been slated into the number three slot. I don't see them moving anywhere anytime soon. Same thing with Milwaukee, who is slated at the number six slot. The winner of this series will play the winner of the Cleveland Cavaliers versus the Indiana Pacers. A lot of people are saying that the Indiana Pacers, if they can beat Cleveland, is going to run through Toronto. But at the same time, people are saying that we're fortunate that we don't have to go Indiana and then Cleveland.
That would be brutal.
Yeah, at least in this situation, the two powerhouses are going against each other first. And, I mean, as weird as this is going to sound, hopefully they'll beat each other up. And whoever we play in the second round will be battered. In terms of Milwaukee, really and truly, the only two players you got to get through are Greg Monroe and the Greek freak.
Giannis, I'm not even going to attempt his last name.
Anakanapombo. I can never say it. It's always ridiculous. It's insane. I can't. Can you do it?
No, I can't. I don't even know his. I know it starts with an A and it ends with an S somewhere.
True. So for those of you tuned in for the first or on a regular basis, you guys know that Zayn usually is the one to give you the news. So I'm going to give you what Zayn had on his list. Hopefully in the next minute. Counterfeit $50 and $100 bills are being circulated in London. Police in London, Ontario are warning the public and retailers that counterfeit 50 and hundreds are being circulated. They say there's a recent increase in counterfeits that mimic those in the Scenes of Canada series of notes from 1969 to 79. The bills are not polymer or primarily $100 notes. Old bills are currently out of circulation, while valid, but be suspicious. New poll finds Torontonians support $15 minimum wage. A new poll released by Forum Research found that a strong majority of Torontonians support a $15 minimum wage. 840 people were randomly sampled, and 70% responded that they would support bumping it from $11.40 to $15. Uber Pool expanding to Scarborough and Brampton. Uber announced that starting today, Uber Pool will now be available to residents in Scarborough and Brampton. The Cheesecake Factory to open first Canadian location in Yorkdale Mall. The U.S. restaurant chain, The Cheesecake Factory, will be opening in at Yorkdale Mall this coming fall. It will bring its 250 large portion menu items to Toronto, and the closest Cheesecake Factory location to Toronto is in Buffalo, just across the border. With that being said, that wraps up tonight's news. I hope you guys heard me flinging papers everywhere tonight, because that is how I felt.
That was a lot of news to cover, and I appreciate the fact that you did that all of that in 10 minutes.
I think it was a pretty good 10 minutes? That's a lot of time, though.
It is a lot of time, but it was a lot of news.
It was a lot of news. There's a lot going around on and around the world. And if I missed anything, please let me know on any of our social media links. When we come back from break, Zayn will give you guys those links once again. But we will be back because we do have to take a commercial break. Stay tuned, guys.
We'll be back.
True.
This is Urban Definition. Urban Definition. On CHHA 1610.
Welcome back to Urban Definition, everyone. For those of you tuning in right now, I just want to remind you to the listeners to visit our website, urbandefinition.ca, and find us on social media to talk to us during the show. And that's going to be especially helpful because right now we're about to head into real talk. And
is it really?
Yeah.
You know what's funny? I expected to come back from the commercial break and for some reason throw to tech talk.
We can do that, actually.
No, we're not doing that. We're not doing that. I have Real Talk in my hands right now, but it was just funny because when we went out to commercial, I was mentally preparing myself for Tech Talk.
Yeah, I think that's what we've been doing the last couple weeks, actually.
Fair enough. Well, either way, let's get to our Real Talk topic of the night, which is Quebec daycares urge to positively welcome roughhousing for boys. At dozens of daycares in Quebec, staff will soon be encouraged to take a new approach to roughhousing, allowing it instead of breaking it up. They will allow war games and battle games, but in a structured environment. It's done within the rules, so it's not as violent. This statement coming from Carolyn Payer, Director General of La Maison de Familion, Familion? This is when I wish Sassan was here to give us the
French pronunciation. The proper
exactly.
En français.
Exactly. But this approach is part of a new reference guide to be unveiled later today or today at some point by community groups and daycare workers in the region. The guide was developed as an educational tool to better support managers and daycare workers, especially when it comes to boys' development. So I'm going to, instead of continuing to talk about this, what I'm going to do is I'm going to open tonight's conversation with the question, do we currently have an issue with male masculinity?
I don't think so, because, let's peel back this onion a little bit. The first problem is you're going to let kids fight each other, which I understand, kids will be kids and they kind of have to go through these things. But to encourage it is a different ballgame altogether, because encouraging it teaches these kids that it's okay to do this for a conflict resolution, that there's no other way to resolve it. And instead of using your words, you use your fists, and especially amongst boys. The second layer of this is that in terms of conflict resolution, that may be true when it comes to other guys, but there are definitely more peaceful ways to deal with this. And when these kids grow up to become adults, is this what it's going to carry over with their adult lives? So are we stuck in the 1940s and 50s here? This is what you see about domestic abuse. This is how violent parents come about. This is how a culture is created.
So the way that you're approaching this is you see this as you're essentially teaching boys, young boys, that conflict resolution equals physical, being physical.
Yeah, and then, to even go even further with this, you're saying about masculinity, isn't the rhetoric of the last 4 to 5 years at the least about breaking gender norms and societal structure on what gender is supposed to be? Now you're saying you're more masculine if you're fighting it out. So what about the guys who don't like to fight or don't find that to be useful?
True. I'm going to kind of elaborate on that, on the gender roles, because what the organization says is that boys often have a harder time adapting to daycare and schools than girls. The numbers are quite telling when it comes to school success rates. Boys have a higher dropout rate and fail more in school. The problem for the According to what this Carolyn Payer is saying, she says the problem is for an entire gender. Boys and men not adapting to changing job market. We always say intervention needs to start early, so we think we are the foundation. It's important to start worrying about this problem, which could come up in the future.
Okay, but then, sorry, can you continue on that?
Sure. The report itself is titled Better Supporting Our Boys. It's a 28-page report, including 6 winning practices. These practices are this: welcome all children with kindness, give a place to each child in the group, create an environment that is conducive to building a masculine identity, positively welcome war games and battle games, create opportunities for challenges and competitions, and enrich reading activities. So 3 out of the points that I just listed there really push the whole concept of male masculinity being tough. I don't approach it the same way as you, though.
Why war? Why not sport?
Well, the war part I don't get. The competition and challenges I agree with.
That I agree, because that's sport, though.
Because something that I don't like is this whole concept of participation trophies now.
I see where you're coming from there.
In that regard, I sort of agree and I sort of get where they're coming from. For me, the way that I approached this when I first heard about this topic was that boys are not being raised mentally tough enough to deal with real life challenges.
Mm-hmm.
Boys in general, and I'm not trying to solidify that there is gender roles, but if you look at the way that certain job fields play out, for example, construction work, that is a predominantly male driven industry.
Given the physical,
men are considered to be the trade workers. Let's get it straight. A lot of the foremen, the people supervising them, are becoming more females, which I have no issues with. But either way, the trade workers tend to be males. And the way that I saw this was we need to prepare these boys who will become these trade workers to be mentally tough to deal with some of the
Bless you.
Thanks. I felt it coming.
I think it's the first time anyone's ever sneezed on air between us.
Oh, I feel terrible now. No, you've done it once. I'd like to think
I know that I've had sniffles for sure.
I'd like to think that you did it at least once, but either way, yeah, I guess I sneezed for the first time on air. That sucked. But either way, what I was saying before was that I feel like this is an attempt to socially condition these boys to become mentally tough, so that when they have to deal with issues such as layoffs or downsizing or anything, really and truly, it comes down to anything. There's so many different ways that you need to be mentally prepared and mentally tough in a certain way.
I get that, but I think that could be better presented than roughhousing. I don't think roughhousing – I mean, I understand why or how that presents the lesson.
I get that. I understand exactly what you're saying.
Well, I just don't see the point of that being the like.
I agree. Yeah, I agree with you in that sense. And I guess the only response that I can conjure up to that is that it can be argued that, you know, a lot of boys these days are becoming a little bit overly sensitive or perceived as being overly sensitive when it comes to certain things. And I think there's a certain degree of quote-unquote toughness that some people feel boys on the whole are lacking these days.
Well, you're always going to have your alpha and your beta people, right? You're always going to have someone who stands out more, who is mentally tough more. And I think that just comes down to who they are as a person as well. I don't think it's necessarily like everyone's becoming more hypersensitive. I think it's more of allowance and freedom to be that way. I think people were always like that. There wasn't a nurturing space for them to do that. And if someone's more mentally stronger or stable or whatever the case is with that they're trying to go for here, that's fine. And you should encourage that. It's the other people. I don't see the point of roughhousing. I think introducing sport, I think creating challenges for them to do that, that's the point of it.
Okay, so then my question is, to close out tonight's Real Talk topic, is this. Do you see this structure or this plan panning out, or do you think this is something that'll probably die off faster, sooner, rather than later, and a little bit of why?
I think it'll die off soon because I don't think everyone's going to be on board with this, and I think a larger discussion needs to happen, and it will happen, especially of parents with kids who are going to come home with black eyes and bruises.
Fair enough. Okay. That's literally the rhetoric that we're going with. It's the physical aspect of things.
What were your thoughts?
I don't know. It's really tricky. It's such a complex, because I see points on both sides. For me, I feel like this is something that's going to be tested, and then it'll probably start for about a year, and then after a year, they'll be like, whoops, we made a huge mistake. Let's never do this again.
Yeah.
I agree with you to the point where it's going to become more about physical and less about mental toughness.
Exactly.
Glad we agree. We'll be back after the break, guys. Stay tuned for Tech Talk.
Urban. Definition. On CHHA 1610. Urban. Definition. On CHHA 1610.
Welcome back, everyone, to Urban Definition. It is now Kareem's favorite time of the show. It's Tech Talk time. Is it?
All right.
Well, I've never introduced Tech Talk before like this.
You've never introduced Tech Talk at all.
I have.
Really?
I've usually been like, hey, welcome back from the break, and now it's time for Tech Talk.
Oh, well, here was to trying a new thing.
Well, I mean, we never really discussed it, but we definitely should have this conversation afterwards. And again, for those listeners tuning in right now, go to Urban Definition, click on our social media site, on our social media tabs, and talk to us, because especially with the fact that we don't have Sassan here to do this today, I'm going to be taking over, and I think I would like to have discussions with people on what's going on in the tech world. All right, here's what's actually happening, though. The first thing. Don't run commercials designed to trigger smart assistant. Burger King is debuting a new 15-second ad today set to start running across America. It starts off simple enough. It's a dude standing behind the counter of an otherwise empty restaurant, and he's addressing the camera. He explains that he doesn't have time to fully explain an iconic hamburger to you. Now, ad time isn't cheap, even for the very successful fast food joint. So, he's got an idea. He's going to use your smart home assistant, Google Home in this case. Okay, Google, he addresses the camera, and he's asking a question designed to trigger devices across the country, reading the first few sentences of the foodstuff's Wikipedia entry. Now, it's a massive company that paid an ad agency a lot of money for a spot, so it has to be interactive and cool and playing on the trend of countless people who have bought Echo, which is triggered by Amazon commercials, not to mention the nightmare that is everyone who named Alexa walking all over for the last couple of years. Are you with me so far?
Totally am. I love how you looked at me like you were waiting for me to laugh at the Alexa joke.
Well, I mean, as long as you're with me.
Totally am.
So let's just nip this whole thing in the bud right now, okay? This ad was inevitable. Someone was going to get there, and the folks at Burger King beat everyone to the punch. For the company, it's a way to extend advertising beyond the screen. I mean, between Kendall Jenner ending police violence with a can of sugar water.
I can't believe that happened.
I know, right? United executing the literal manifestation of how we all feel about air travel.
I also can't believe that happened.
And Sean Spicer, as you mentioned before, being, well, Sean Spicer.
I can believe that one happened.
Who can't? The ad campaign likely won't register a blip on anyone's radar. I don't think it'll make that much of an effect. Although I will say this. There was one time a commercial with Siri, with the Cookie Monster using Siri. It was an iPhone commercial. And a friend of mine who was in the room watching TV with me, when the Cookie Monster said, "Siri, set timer," my friend's phone actually set a timer for him. It was like, Siri was like, "Okay, setting timer."
Ah, very interesting.
So I can see why they would do this kind of thing. It makes sense. It's pretty cool. But it also could be annoying. And let's see how far this really goes. At best, it is going to be annoying for people with their device in the living room. At the worst, though, if it comes up again and it has some nagging questions about technological limitations and privacy concerns surrounding these smart assistants. Now, for starters, there's the issue of tech limitations of such a device. It seems that we're still a ways from starting from smart assistants that are capable of distinguishing voices from one another. So, a voice that tells that I'm Zayn and that you're Kareem. And while I'm sure that the company and its connected ad agency have no malicious intent beyond selling some hamburgers after all, this limitation becomes a larger concern for the more of our life that we turn over to these devices.
Agreed.
Which is essentially the same thing as, again, Siri or, in this case, Burger King.
For sure, I agree with that.
The next thing. Google's Speak to Go is actually going to let you travel the globe with your voice.
What?
Yeah, check this out. Today, Google showed off a host of VR web applications on its new Web VR Experiments page, one of which lets you explore the world using voice search. Now, Speak to Go is optimized to work with VR headsets on its Daydream and Cardboard platforms. You can also try it on your phone or computer without a headset, but you just need to enable the mic on Chrome and get to voice exploring. On desktop, the app is a gimmicky voice search tool for Google Maps. It's not that great. But on a Google Cardboard headset, you get a more real sense of exploration as you're cut off from other forms of input and it's just you and you're moving your head to explore. That's it. The app showcases the strengths of Web VR in getting new users into experiences that are seamless and intuitive. Web VR also allows users to visit virtual reality experiences in a browser by just visiting a URL.
So hold on, you're telling me that I can now go on an African safari in Africa?
Yeah.
Damn.
With just your VR headset.
That is badass.
That's what I'm saying, right? Now, in November 2016, just last year, Google debuted its Earth application on HTC's Vive platform. Vive or Vive?
I think it's Vive. Or Vive.
Vive? So they debuted it on the Vive app platform, sorry. Now, this latest update brings some of the views to a mobile 360 on Cardboard and Daydream. And it provides a legit reason that Google is rated one of the top companies to work for. Because at the end of the day, who wouldn't want to be part of this technological progress, right?
They won't hire me.
They won't hire you. They won't hire me, but they might hire Sass.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
I mean, unless you and I learn coding like crazy, then they'll take us.
Nah, but that is super cool.
The next thing, Facebook Moments is getting a standalone website. Now, if you remember, Facebook released an app on your phone called Moments, and to the web in a limited capacity by adding a link to the service in the desktop version of Facebook. Now, Facebook is expanding Moments again to the web, but this time it's setting a standalone website for the service that offers access to albums you've previously shared with friends. So, and we'll get into this actually. Let me continue. However, the stripped-down version of Moments within Facebook, the web version, is similarly non-functional. The site displays the full list of albums you've created as well as who they've been shared with, but the common features you thought you'd get in the web version of the photo sharing app simply don't work. For example, the buttons for favoriting or commenting on photos don't work. Instead, they prompt a pop-up box to appear which directs you to download the Moments mobile app. You can choose to enter in your phone number in this box or have it texted to your phone. Essentially, it's a marketing site for the mobile app.
I'm so glad you broke that down because I was like, whoa, this is like really complex.
it's just advertising for it. Now, also unavailable on the web version is the ability to work with your photos or albums in any other way. Now, that begs the question, the obvious question, why bother to have a web version of Moments at all?
I was wondering that.
I mean, the answer is actually pretty simple. It gives a way for people who don't have the Moments app installed the ability to view photos you're sharing with them.
That's scary, because that means that, like, family who don't have, like, Facebook Moments can now, like, hop on the computer
and see what you're up to.
And see my Moments.
Yep, they can see all of it, Kareem.
Oh, God.
Facebook confirmed the website launched recently, but didn't offer to share its longer-term plans for Moments on the web moving forward. So we don't know where this is really going to go.
It's one of those things where you have to wait and see what happens.
But I feel like if it's just a marketing site for the mobile app, it's going to die down.
I don't know. Facebook, are they a public trading site yet?
Yeah, they've been for a while, haven't they?
I feel like this is just going to help.
They're on the stock market.
Yeah, I feel like this is just going to help, like, rocket their stocks. Because, I mean, at the end of the day, this might not be something that a lot of people will utilize, but I can definitely see how external companies, marketing and stuff like that, they'll be like, oh my God, this is a trend. We need to hop onto this. And then as such, Facebook's stock will go up, will rise.
Well, the interesting thing is things that are available on phone are not always available. And this is going to be one of the first things because Instagram, for example, you couldn't get Instagram on your computer, on your desktop.
Yeah, now you can.
Well, you can log in. You still can't post photos.
No, you can't post, but you can view others.
But that's the thing. I want to post photos from my computer, right?
I guess, yeah, I see that. You still have to, like, connect your cell phone, download from your computer onto your phone, and then post from your phone.
Yeah, which is still going to be, I mean, so that's what I see apps as being the same thing. It's just, you can view it.
Yeah,
can't do
I see
anything
that.
Else.
Yeah.
But if I'm correct, and I'm hoping this is the same, because Instagram, the privacy setting works that if you have your account on private, mm-hmm. I can't see your account unless I'm logged in and I actually follow you or whatever the case is.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping that Moments works the same way because Instagram is owned by Facebook, if I'm not correct.
I'm not sure. I think you're right.
I think
but
it
I don't
is.
Remember.
And so with that, if your account settings are that, you know, certain, like the public can't see it unless they're your friend.
Your privacy settings are, yeah.
Yeah, then hopefully that's what it's going to be.
Hopefully. We'll see.
Then it's like, well, if you wanted to share pictures of me but I don't have the actual app, I can just go online and be like, well, I'm Kareem's friend and I can see his pictures.
That's scary.
It's not as bad as it sounds, though.
All it takes is one person to log in and forget to log out.
That's true. Moving on. Microsoft Windows 10 Creators Update is rolling out today, and here are the top features.
Yeah, that's big news.
That's right. So Microsoft announced the public release for Windows 10 Creators Update on March 31st, and it starts rolling out this week. So here are some of the updates. Number one, the Windows 10 ecosystem. Now, for starters, the new Paint 3D app will let Microsoft users create or modify 3D objects and give them the ability to change color and texture on these. They can also turn 2D images into 3D objects. Creators can then share these on Remix 3D or print them out in 3D form via 3D printer. So for those of you who want the small gist of that, basically you can now make your photos 3D or make some objects 3D and print it out.
Like convert it to 3D and then print it out on a 3D printer.
Yeah. And I'm not sure if, like, it says 2D images, so I'm hoping it's like pictures. You can imagine you had a nice family photo, you can now make it 3D.
That's pretty cool.
That would be pretty cool. I'm not really sure how that works. And for those of you who don't know, by the way, Remix3D.com is Microsoft's online community where users can connect with each other and other 3D creators. And it gives them access to a library of 3D objects to use, customize, and then reprint and do as they will. Number two, better tab management. Tab management features will let users get a preview visual thumbnail of all their open tabs. And if you're like me, you have open tabs all over the place, all the time, for a certain amount of YouTube videos you're going to watch, or Netflix, or whatever the case is.
Sounds about right.
Users can also set aside a group of tabs for a cleaner look. And I feel that's going to be very nice, because you know how Windows is always marketing on their professionalism?
Yep.
And their professional cut and their look? I think that's going to be a really good, helpful feature for future businesses. And I can see that actually going far. Number four, Microsoft is also adding Microsoft Wallet for a better online shopping experience. If you're like me, this doesn't really do much for you because I just use my credit card for everything anyway.
Yeah, but now you can have like using your credit card for everything, you can buy like dollars or you can buy increments and then use that wallet across.
Or I could just put in my credit card number.
Yeah, but you don't always have your credit card on you.
I do actually.
Really?
Someone like me, yeah, and I have all the numbers memorized.
That's scary.
That's how much I've been using my credit card.
That's also scary.
Which I feel like Microsoft needs to add a stop spending app. That's what they need to do.
Yep, sounds about right.
Speaking of which, five, improve security. Windows Defender Security Center, which is a central hub, lets users control device security from a single dashboard. Also, the Microsoft account page will show security and health status for all your Windows PCs and tablets on the dashboard in one go, which is very helpful. So imagine like your YouTube, My Channels page or Creator Studio, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like that's what it's going to be like. So you can see everything all at once and you have all your information and go about as you please. And last but not least, Windows Photos. Microsoft has been paying attention to this for a little while now. Users can now organize, personalize, and share memories with better controls. The new update will allow users to try on Windows Ink to draw on top of their pictures and videos before sharing them. And as a user, you can search for photos based on tag, time, place, people, etc. Which is very similar to what my iPhone is doing right now.
Except Apple does all that for you, and sometimes it doesn't archive it the right way or send it to the wrong way, or face recognition picks up the wrong face and it thinks that you are me, like most of our graduating class.
Yo, even my cousin told me last week, actually, like, he's like, you know, you and Kareem look really much alike. I would pass you guys as brothers. And I was like, you know what? Been there, done that.
Been there, done that, indeed. Thanks, Zane's cousin.
But yeah, that's all for tech that I have today.
That was a good tech talk.
Thank you. I hope that was informative. I hope I engage people. I know this is my first time doing tech talk, so I apologize if people lost me or were a little lost.
So my question is then, of tonight's various tech talk topics and areas of discussion, as somebody who doesn't necessarily utilize or really involve himself in the tech world, do you see yourself, and be honest, do you see yourself utilizing or taking advantage of any of the things that you've discussed tonight?
I'm definitely a little bit scared about that Burger King thing,
mm-hmm.
because I don't want it to go into my house.
Well, I think the whole thing with that was that, like, for example, the Amazon Echo.
Yeah.
Was it last week or a couple weeks ago? Oh, for April Fool's Day. For April Fool's Day, Jimmy Kimmel brought on a guy, and I forget his name, I'll give it to you later, but he works at NASA, and he actually played that prank on everybody, where if you had an Amazon Echo in your house, he basically ordered like 250 floaties.
Damn.
And people were complaining because it actually worked, where he was like, hey Amazon, turn the volume all the way up, and then it turns it all the way up, and then he goes, Alexa, buy me 250 floaties. And they're like, confirming, do you want to buy this? And he goes, yep, ordering, estimated time of delivery, 2 weeks.
So, dude, that's funny now, but in the wrong hands? That's terrible.
That's scary. But either way, that's what you're telling me we're moving towards now, where Burger King is going to order 50 million burgers on your TV. Either way, Great tech talk, Zayn.
Thank you.
We're taking a commercial break. Stay tuned.
We'll be back.
One more time. Great job.
This is Urban Definition. This is Urban Definition.
I got some wicked acid reflux. I don't know why, but maybe it's an age thing. As I get older, I'm suffering.
That happens. When you get older, like, your body just starts breaking down on you, man.
Has it started with you yet?
No, thankfully.
Oh, man.
I mean, I started wearing glasses a couple years ago, and I'm hoping that's the latest that happens.
I did remember that when you started wearing glasses. That was a big deal to you.
I've been going back to the gym because I do not want my body to deteriorate on me.
Welcome back from the commercial break, everybody. For your information, these are the kind of conversations that Zayn and I just randomly have.
Quite more often than you'd think.
If you would like to take part in our random conversations, Zayn, tell us how they can.
Just find us on Facebook, man. UrbanDefinition.ca. Click on the Facebook and Twitter tabs and just talk to us. Honestly, the more random, the more fun it can get.
Zayn just got really weird there. It was great. He was like laughing. He's like, honestly, dude, just Facebook us.
Oh, that's the thing, right?
It is.
Talk
it
to
is.
Us.
That's a good.
Be a part of line. Our conversation, no matter how random it is.
Nice. So, Zayn, tell us what's going on in the city this weekend.
For sure. Well, for those of you who know and should know by now, it's the long weekend. It's Easter long weekend. So for those of you celebrating for religious reasons, happy
for
Easter.
For religious reasons?
Yeah.
Celebrating for whatever.
Celebrating because it's religious to you. It's not religious for me, so I'm taking advantage of the day off. I'm sorry, but that's the truth for me.
Sorry, it's just the realities of life.
But for those of you who this is a religious holiday, happy Easter in advance, because we're not going to obviously be on air during the weekend. So here's what's going to be going down for the rest of us who are not sitting and praying. Friday, it's the 2017 Toronto Salsa Festival, and it actually starts the pre-party on Thursday, but the whole rest of the competition starts from Friday to Sunday. It's going to be April 14th to 17th at the Sheridan Center, Toronto. So as I mentioned, the pre-party's tomorrow. The competition starts on Friday and runs until Sunday, and there will be workshops during the day and competitions at night. So you can register for the workshops, and you can attend the competitions. Full details can be found on the website, www.torontosalsafest.com. Again, that's www.torontosalsafest.com. And I actually went to visit the site today, which is where I got this information from. And it seemed pretty cool. It seemed like a very legit thing, and I would like to go had I known before or done some prior research. So for those of you going, let us know what you think. And because we are a Latin radio station, I think a lot of people would be very interested to know. On Friday, you also have – well, actually, since Monday, we've had the Nordstrom Warehouse Sale 2017, and it runs up until this weekend, until Sunday. You can find up to 80% off clothing, accessories, and footwear for men, women, and children from Nordstrom and its brands. It's going to be at the International Center, Hall 6, 10 a.m. to 9 p.m. on Friday, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. on Saturday and Sunday. Now, for those of you who are not sure what Nordstrom is, if you have taken a recent trip down to the Eaton Center or Yorkdale Mall or even Sherway Gardens, you'll know what Nordstrom is. It's a large department store, a very high end, and the fact that it's 80% off a lot of things is pretty good. I mean, not everything you're going to buy, but for those, you know, few things that are actually really nice, let's hope you get a good discount on them. On Saturday, pancakes and waffles at TIFF Kids International Film Festival. You heard me correctly. From 10 a.m. to 1 p.m., there will be pancakes and waffles served as breakfast before the screening of Garfield for kids at the TIFF Lightbox as part of TIFF Kids International Film Festival. Breakfast will be served 45 minutes prior to the screening time, and you must have a ticket to access breakfast. So if you don't have a ticket, buy one, and if you don't buy one, you cannot have pancakes and waffles for at the Bell TIFF Lightbox.
That sounded like such a punishment. You cannot have pancakes and waffles.
It is a punishment. You know how good pancakes and waffles are on a weekend?
That's true.
Not just anything, just brunch or breakfast or even dinner sometimes.
You're too much sometimes. You're too much.
You know what? I've just been craving those things, actually. I really have.
I can't blame you.
I really have. On Saturday, you also have the market. And I hope I'm saying this right, because I know this is something that you actually mentioned to me and then I saw later on.
Yeah, my homie Jaleesa invited me to it. So I thought that I should share that with you guys. So I passed it on to Zayn, and now Zayn's reading it.
For sure. Well, the market is a public shopping event produced by the Toronto Creative Entrepreneurs and Kareem's Friends. It's open to members of the community, and it features up to 50 vendors, including fashion, beauty, art, handmade goods, home decor, food merchants, live entertainment, on-stage demonstrations, and much more, as if I already did not list enough. It's going to be at the Holiday Inn Toronto Yorkdale from 12 p.m. to 6 p.m. on both Saturday and Sunday. So you should definitely check those things out.
Dope.
Yeah, and I feel like I'm missing something. Oh, well, we mentioned that the Leafs are playing tomorrow for the first time in the playoffs since, what is it, 2013?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I love how you're so adamant. I took that out of your original script, and you were like, why'd you take it out? Put it back in.
Yeah, because it's something that's happening this weekend.
Either way, if you're going out this weekend, guys, have fun. If you're driving to the cottage, mind those gas prices. It should be relatively decent. It is scheduled to rain, but I'm hoping that clears up in the next couple days. Anything else?
Well, if you're going to go watch the Leafs and or Raptors on Saturday, just know that that area is going to be packed. I mean, you got both teams in the playoffs for the first time in years together, True. Plus the Jays playing. That whole area is something to avoid if you're driving and you're trying to get through downtown. If you're going for that, by all means, have a lot of fun. But, you know, just be careful. And as Kareem says, as usual, be responsible. Because sports, and we talked about this in Roughhousing, we get emotional. We get, you know, caught up in the moments. Be safe. Don't be dumb. Don't do stupid things. Cheer on your team. Regardless of the score, because this is Toronto, we have, you know, a usual curse ahead of us. Don't get that upset. Start to expect things.
Zane's rambling at this point.
I am.
I don't know why you're rambling.
I got to fill in some time.
You don't have no time to fill in. It's all good. If you guys go out, have a fantastic weekend. I usually end every show by saying live, love, learn. We're all students of life. Have a great weekend, everybody.
Urban definition. On CHHA 1610.